The next 30 minutes or so, I'm going to discuss with you whether the unusual transplant from a very close donor is a hope for cure of thalassemia or just a hype. So the agenda for my talk today, we are going to discuss rapidly the transfusion-dependent thalassemia measure, the threats of the slow killer, and what are the goals of therapy, and what are the commonly used therapy options, transfusion chelation and matched stable allogeneic transplant. And then we'll discuss whether the transplant is really an important option, is it a necessity or just an option, and what if the regular transplant, the matched sibling transplant is not available, and can we go for haploidentical transplant or not? So for the stress of the major thalassemia major is that you see that if untreated, as happened in the past, in before the 60s, you see how rapidly fatal is the disease, patients seldom live to the age of 30. And then with the improvement of the transfusion chelation, and when we realize that the survival of the patient is actually required, requiring that this patient should be transfused as much as possible to help him grow, has definitely improved the outcome decade after decade. And then we realize that the cost of this transfusion is that iron overload that is slowly is going to kill the patient from cardiac or liver failure. And you see here how the transfusion-dependent thalassemia measure is going to kill the patient sooner or later, either due to cardiac failure or liver problem or endocrine dysfunction and abnormality. The goals of therapy are actually, in my view, that we need to extend this shortened survival caused by the transfusion-dependent thalassemia, and having a good quality of life, because having surviving is not the only important factor. And I would like to add that this should occur in at a reasonable cost, with reasonable utilization of resources. Otherwise, this is not going to be sustainable. So the therapy options, the first line of therapy, the standard is transfusion chelation, usually the child, once he has been diagnosed as severely anemic due to thalassemia major, is going to be transfused, and sooner or later, after several transfusions, he is going to be iron overloaded and requiring iron chelation. And we see that the rationale for the transfusion chelation is to prolong survival by controlling anemia and iron overload. And you see here that blood transfusion actually will stop most of the death cycle caused by thalassemia, caused by anemia, that causes increased absorption and increased erythropoietin level, which will cause a tremendous marrow expansion with skeletal deformities. And this also would happen at the cost of iron overload, with ensuing cardiac and liver failure. So if you give transfusion, you will probably correct the anemia and try to decrease or normalize the rate of iron absorption, and will stop the expanding marrow from causing expanded erythrin and skeletal deformities. However, it's not going to be a therapy for the iron chelation, for the iron overload. Even it is going to be an additional factor that will increase the iron overload. So not only transfusion is important, but also you need to have an extensive program and compliance with oral iron chelation. And if you are going to do this way in a very ideal fashion, probably a thalassemic patient may live in a reasonable life expectancy and quality of life. The second option is a matched sibling allogeneic transplant, and we see the rationale for this is that standard matched sibling transplant can prolong survival by replacing the diseased marrow by a healthy one, and it will be a curative. However, you need to remember that the early transplant related mortality of this procedure is not simple. So the village of transplant in Selesema actually lied in Italy, in Pesaro. It's on the east coast of Italy. You see it here, it's a beautiful city. And this person, Lucarelli, I consider him the father of transplant in Selesema. And these are the data of Lucarelli for the Pesaro outcome of the transplant. And you see that the outcome, the overall survival of the class 1 and class 2 Pesaro score is almost 100%, and the Selesema free survival is 90%, and even in the class 3, if he is less than 17, if he's a child or a young adult, again the overall survival is high, 90%, and the Selesema free survival is 90%. However, if you go to class 3 in adults, the outcome will be not fantastic. You can lose almost one third of your patient if you go for a transplant. These are the magnificent data of Lucarelli for class 1, almost 90% survival, overall survival, and Selesema free survival, and the transplant related mortality was less than 10%, and the rejection rate was less than 5%. The same more or less with the class 2, excellent survival, and if you look for class 3, if they are children, the outcome would be a bit less favorable with the survival and Selesema free survival around 85%, and the transplant related mortality in their hands rose to 15%, and the rejection based on some methodology to prevent rejection was almost negligible. We have a phenomena in transplant in Selesema that we do not accept when we are transplanting malignant conditions. Mixed chimerism. We do not accept mixed chimerism when transplanting leukemia, acute leukemia, because this means return of the disease. However, in benign condition and Selesema in particular, we can accept some degree of mixed chimerism where the host and donor cells are still present. So based on the degree of the residual recipient or residual host cells, we can grade the mixed chimerism into level 1, level 2, and level 3, and you see the corresponding figures, and you see this is more than 25%. I'm sorry, it's not the level 3, 25%. And the outcome of this mixed chimerism actually will depend on the degree and the level of mixed chimerism. So we can see and we can accept mixed chimerism in almost one third of patients early on at post-transplant beyond at day 60. And the outcome of this mixed chimerism will be dependent on the, as we discussed, on the level of the chimerism. So it can be a transient mixed chimerism in 20% of patients, or it can persist for life up to 10% of patients at the post-transplant year 2. And you see the transient mixed chimerism either can go into complete chimerism or graft rejection. However, patients who survive with a persistent mixed chimerism at the year 2 post-transplant can have, despite having the stem cell, both of the donor and recipient origin. However, if you blood group the peripheral blood, you will see that what you can see in the peripheral blood is the red cells from the donor rather than from the recipient, and most of these patients are transfusion independent. So you can accept some degree of mixed chimerism if it's a small clone and associated with keeping the patient transfusion independent, which is the goal of therapy of the Selesema. So the outcome of mixed chimerism again will depend on the level of chimerism initially, and you see that in level 1 up to to 30% of patients can continue to have persistent mixed chimerism. If you go for level 3, possibility of turning into complete chimerism is almost zero, but still you have a 10% possibility that this patient will go into persistent mixed chimerism and no transfusion dependency. So the lessons from Basil was actually that you can transplant class 1, class 2, class 3, and even adults, but you have to be careful in transplanting class 3 and adults. So in general, you have to use a myeloablative conditioning or nearly ablative conditioning to apply this expanded recipient erythroid clone or erythrum. And in class 1 and class 2, you do not need additional immune suppression before the transplant. However, if you go to class 3 or adults, you need to do some immune suppression before the transplant. That will take a month or two, and it was in the Basil protocols, hydroxyurea and azacitidine, and then they added one cycle of fludarabine just prior to the transplant by a week or two. So now we can discuss whether transplant is an option or a necessity. So let us examine from the patient perspective the life expectancy for a transplant option versus no transplant. So again, the transplant is a curative line of therapy that that expected to prolong survival. However, we discussed that this is a risky procedure. So again, from another city in Italy, now in the south, from Cagliari in Italy, they had a long-term survival study of almost 1,000 patients, 500 patients with beta thalassemia major transplanted compared to a case control patient without a transplant. So they were able to have a very long-term follow-up of such a transplant patients and compare them with case-controlled non-transplant patient. And you see in green the overall survival of the conventional therapy at 85% compared to 82 in the transplant arm and 79 or 80% as a thalassemia-free survival. So you see here that transplant is actually not superior to non-transplant with regard to the overall survival. I do believe these are their data, but I think Dr. Ala is going to give us how the transplant here in Egypt, having the limited resources that is needed for the continuation of the transfusion and chelation, would actually put the transplant at a superior or a survival advantage compared to non-transplant. But these are the data from Italy, and I guess this is the only comparative study that compared the transplant versus transfusion or no transplant. And even in adults, you see that the conventional therapy was more or less similar to transplant. So transplant doesn't have a clear survival advantage from the numerical point of view. If you look for the outcome of the transplant and transfusion by year post-transplant, you see at the age of 2 years post-transplant, the survival of no transplant is better at 5 years, at 10 years, and only at 30 years, you started to see the similarity of the survival of the transplant versus no transplant, because at that time, patients with thalassemia are going to die due to complications. And at that time, if you look for the long-term mortality of the transplant, around 15% or 20%, it's more or less similar to the non-transplant with different reasons. And now in the non-transplant, you see most of the patients dying from cardiac issues. But is survival the only option? Is it the only important parameter? Or do we know we have to address how these people would live, the quality of life? Can we accept survival alone without looking for the quality of life, the extended survival versus the quality adjusted life year gained. So if you have these two options for any disease, and you have a therapy in red that prolongs life by 8 years, and another line of therapy that prolongs life for 10 years, definitely the green line of therapy is better, because numerically it has a survival advantage of an additional 2 years of extended survival. But look for the quality of life. If these patients are living additional 10 years are living in hospital, or more or less in hospital, not able to work, not able to marry, not able to be productive person in the country, in the society, with a quality of life of 30%. Now we can calculate the quality adjusted life year gain, compared to the a bit looking shorter line of therapy giving only 8 years, with a quality of life of 60 or 70%. Now simple calculation will tell you the quality gained with green line of therapy is 10 times 0.3 means 3 quality, and for the red line of therapy 8 times 0.6 4.8 quality. So red line therapy is better with regard not only survival alone, but if you look for the quality of life of this patient. So this is again from Lucarelli, long-term health-related quality of life evaluated more than 20 years after hematopoietic stem cell transplantation for thalassemia, and he was able to show that ex-thalassemic patient would more or less live a life, have a quality of life that is more or less close to the normal persons, normal population. So if you have a transplanted patient with thalassemia and he survived 1 or 2 years, he's going to live as if he has no thalassemia. So this is different. The psychological issue, let us examine an ideal day in a thalassemic, in a patient with a thalassemic life. So the best imagined quality of life of a well-compliant transfusion-dependent thalassemia major is to call an Uber, because nobody will help him to go to the hospital each month or each 3 weeks, going to a very nice friend in the hospital for blood draw, check blood cells, iron stores, liver, kidney, blood sugar, and cross-match. Waiting for the best doctor, and he's the best friend of him in the clinic, handling the test results, questioned, are you compliant with the pills? Don't forget again, out of the clinic with drug prescription, transfusion orders, how many red bags I'm going to receive today, the pharmacy chain, and then waiting for the red bags, another skin cut, chills from the transfusion reaction, call an Uber, back home, back to life, if he's a child, back to dad, to school, to kids if he's going to marry, to work, and doing this every 3 weeks, again and again, since I was a kid, again and again for 70 years. Is this a good quality of life? Can you calculate the survival in just these days? So another issue is from parent perspective, the care burden. Definitely having 1 or 2 or 3 thalassemic patients is a tremendous burden to the family. And from the society and healthcare system perspective, the cost effectiveness, and if you don't calculate or don't think of cost effectiveness, nothing will be sustainable. So this is another Italian study comparing, calculating the cost effectiveness of transfusion versus transplant, and it ended with the conclusion that transplant is cost effective, transfusion collection is not cost effective. So, ladies and gentlemen, transplant in transfusion-dependent thalassemia, is it an option or a necessity? I do believe it's a necessity. From the patient perspective, from parent perspective, and even from societal and healthcare system perspective. If so, what if there is no match sibling? Can we go format? This is the data format in one of the review articles, and you can see that the results of MAD is actually less than 10% inferior with regards to both overall survival and transfusion thalassemia free survival if you compare it with the matched sibling. And this is again confirmed by the overall survival data in CIBMTR data format in pediatric patient with thalassemia measure. So it seems that MAD is an acceptable option, but do we have access to MAD? We do not have access to MAD. It's very expensive, and more importantly, if you have the money even, the because of the ethnic differences, we are underrepresented in the donor registry. So even if you have the money and you ask for a MAD donor, it will be very rare possibility. So what if no match, no matched sibling and no MAD? Can we address the question of haplo? This is a review, this is an international survey comparing the outcome of matched sibling, MAD, and haploidentical transplant on almost 1,000 patients less than 25 years who received transplant from matched sibling, mismatched related, which is MAD, matched unrelated MAD, and mismatched unrelated. And most of these patients were actually transplanted in the last decades, and most of these patients were actually requiring very transfusion dependent, and they are not adequately chelated. So they represent rather a common patient we are seeing every day in every clinic. All patients received myeloablative conditioning, and you see here for the transplant procedure, the source of the stem cell source, the GVH prophylaxis, the conditioning, it all was, as I discussed, myeloablative, and you see different methods of GVH prophylaxis, with the only a few patients receiving the bottom line post-transplant cyclo in the haplo. And the haplo patients were actually you see here representing around less than 80 patients in this registry. Look for the outcome in this registry data. The event free survival and overall survival in blue, the matched related donor, and the matched the mismatched related in red. So definitely the overall survival and the event free survival, which means more or less something like thalassemia free survival, definitely the outcome of the haplo is inferior. But again, if you look for the figures for the event free survival, it's around 70%, and the same for the overall survival. So it's not a bad option. So if you believe that you can keep your patients without transplant, with transfusion and adequate chelation to live for the possibility, to have a possibility of survival of 70 years of, okay, don't think of haplo. This is again, if you dissect the outcome, not only by age, by age and donor, and you see here the mismatched related, again, the survival around 75% if it, the donor, if the patient is less than 6 years, and it goes down to almost 60 if you have your patient older than 7 years of age. These are the lessons we got from this registry data, that we should have an ablative conditioning. The donor would definitely affect the outcome, but it's not very bad to go for a mismatched family donor. The problem I guess it more important here in Egypt with the haplos is the graft failure, and you clearly see in red that the mismatched related, which is haplo, is associated with almost 20 to 25% of graft failure compared to less than 10% in other options. This is just confirmation of this data by EBMT data, and you see in B the matched family it's actually mismatched. Mismatched family donor in C, that the possibility of 2 years overall survival is around 70%. Definitely the haplo is inferior, but again, the figures do not look very bad. So what are the haplo nightmares? In the past, we were very, very afraid performing haplo to see hyperacute and fatal GVHD, but now, thanks to the era of post-transplant cycling, this issue is actually diminishing, but still we have the nightmare of rejection. And if you look why we have a high rate of rejection, in particular with thalassemia patient and with particular in haplos, because of the expanded thalassemic erythrin, you need to destroy a huge kilos of expanded thalassemic marrow, and the mismatch, the very active T cells. You look, if you have a transplant, haplo or not, in an acute leukemia, the T cells in the leukemic patients are not as healthy. They are exhausted, are not healthy to reject the graft, while they are very active and are stimulated because of repeated transfusion in thalassemia patients not receiving chemotherapy. And not only this, but the humoral immunity, the donor-specific antibody, sometimes the recipient is having very potent, very selective antibodies that target the unshared antigens on the stem cells. These are the guide, the meta and systematic review of the DSA in haplos and cord blood, and it was clearly associated with almost 7 times the possibility of graft rejection compared to patient without DSA. These are the European guidelines for how to manage DSA positive patients. You see here a lot of plasma exchange, rituxin, IVIG, Buffycoat, if you are going to transplant a patient in a haplo fashion who has a positive DSA. Not only the DSA, as I mentioned, but sometimes the mismatch between the donor and the recipient is actually favoring the rejection rather than of the GVHD. So if you have the recipient, if you is homozygous for some HLA antigens, now the host versus graft vector would be more potent compared to the opposite reaction. So if you have the two bad things, the DSA positive or the host versus graft, the possibility of having a graft rejection is almost 60% compared to almost 10% or less if you do not have neither of these two risk factors. So how to circumvent this? This is another important city in the world that contributed to the management of thalassemia, transplant in thalassemia. Now in the Southeast Asia, in Thailand, in the Mahidol city in Bangkok. So this person actually contributed a lot for the haploidentical transplant in thalassemia. So he was able to modify the conditioning and preconditioning regimens to circumvent the graft rejection and the poor outcome with haploidentical transplant. So this is his modification, the Mahidol protocol. He started first with very early pre-transplant immune suppression protocol, giving two high dose fludarabine. This is the highest dose of fludarabine I have ever seen. 200 milligram per square meter over 5 days, given for 2 cycles with a very high dose of dexamethasone, 25 per square meter dexamethasone daily for 5. This is really high dose dexamethasone, like what we give in myeloma. And this is a very high dose of fludarabine given as early as day minus 70. This not only this, but also several doses of rituximab, of pertuzumab, because rituximab is going to block the memory B cells which are going to secrete later on donor-specific antibodies, pertuzumab will prevent the maturation of these cells into plasma cells. If you have a high titer of DSA, extensive plasma exchange, and of course the regular hypertransfusion intensive chelation to suppress the expanded erythrocyte. The conditioning is reduced toxicity, but he selected to move ATG a bit early to favor anti-graft rejection rather than anti-GVHD. So he moved it a few days before the conditioning, and he selected to use a high dose of stem cells using a peripheral stem cell transplant, and of course the standard post-transplant prophylaxis both side in the haplo regimens as in this. So this is the patient demographics. He was able to haplo-identically transplant 83 patients. These are the patient characteristics, and you see in the age, he transplanted patients up to the age of 30. High risk class 3 in 1/3 of patients. Some had DSA positivity, and of course he used a high dose of CD34. If you look for the transplant complications, the dreadful acute GVHD grade 3 and 4 happened on only 7%, and the extensive GVHD in only 4%. And the problem he had, and the problem we have, is the hemorrhagic cystitis in 1/3 of patients. CEMV, venous occlusive disease, again was important in 20% of patients. CEMV reactivation was a bit common, but the CEMV disease was actually uncommon. So the promise from Mahidol is that the 3-year overall survival with this regimen and the event-free or ischemia-free survival is almost 95%. الصورة بتاعته دي هو بياخد سيلفي اعتقد هو كان بيحاول ياخد سيلفي مع الكيرف يعني كان المفروض ياخد سيلفي مع السرفايفل كيرف احسن ما ياخد مع نفسه يعني he has an excellent survival curve for an 80 patient with thalassemia. So this is the Thalassemia International Federation summary recommendation. So in last year, hematopoietic stem cell transplant should be offered to thalassemic patients and their parents at an early age before complication due to iron overload. And even if an HLA identical sibling if available, either bone marrow or cord blood, a match unrelated can be used provided the compatibility criteria for the class 1 and class 2. Haplo-identical transplant in thalassemia can be considered in experienced centers in the context of well-designed clinical trial. So it's not an experimental therapy. It's a bit therapy that require careful performance. Myeloablative conditioning should always be used as a standard transplant, and post-transplant care should include thalassemia-related look for thalassemia-related complications. And in thalassemia patient, transplant is cost-effective when compared to lifelong supportive therapy. Our experience is a slide from a meeting we had almost 15 years ago where we presented our first patients with haplo and high risk transplant in 2009, almost 14 years. And actually, the second patient with haplo we had performed was a thalassemic patient. She was a child, as I remember, was at the age of 12, with one of the siblings died because of thalassemia complications, and the mother was insisting and arguing to perform a transplant even if it was mismatched. And if you this patient is actually transplanted almost 20 years ago, she's still living, and she rejected, she had mixed chimeras, she didn't reject the graft. At that time, we were not using post-transplant Psy, we were lucky to use CAMPAS, which can cause a lot of graft failure, but this patient survived the transplant, and slowly she rejected the graft, slowly or partially, but remained in a persistent mixed chimeras, and she is not transfusion dependent. The following years, we had only 4 cases because of the transplant bed availability, and after we started our new unit, we had additional 5 cases, and now on board, we have 2 hapless thalassemic patients. So the outcome of these 10 patients, we had 3 deaths and 7 are alive. So the overall survival is 70%. However, to graft failure and back to transfusion chelation, two with persistent mixed chimerism and are transfusion independent, and three with complete chimerism. So this is our criteria. We had a very strict criteria to accept patient. We are not accepting all patients because we are realizing that this is still a high risk procedure, and we do believe if we theoretically have an ideal system for chelation transfusion, maybe this patient will seldom require this a bit risky option. So if we expect that without a transplant, the transfusion chelation with transfusion chelation at year 30, the expected survival of this patient is less than 50. We discuss these issues. He has to perform to be at the age less than 6, and occasionally we accept patients up to the age of 8 and 10. And he has to be not well chelated, because a patient who is well chelated means that he can continue to be well chelated, maybe. And he should not be very poorly chelated, because the transplant outcome will be bad. So it has to be something in between, with class 1 or class 2, and expected progressive iron overload if the parents or the child unlikely to comply with the proper chelation, and both parents insisting, both parents, not only one parent, for haplo despite two transplant committee. We do not accept patients if he is going, I'm going to go for a haplo. He has to come to the transplant committee twice with at least 2 weeks apart and insisting for having the haplo, despite being the haplo immediate mortality is well explained to both parents. At the moment, we do not accept DSA positivity, but I guess as we go on the learning curve, we may accept some of these patients. And so far, we do not prefer if the is the vector in the HVG direction. This is the protocol we have. We have the rituxan and high dose fluorodarabine dexamethasone given 2 cycles early on, plus pertuzumab, 2 doses in the first cycle, 1 dose in the second cycle. We'll try to have to suppress the expanded erythrocyte with hypertransfusion. We have chelation. We continue to use azacitidine and hydroxyurea as per Lucarelli, and we have a reduced toxicity conditioning with ATG starting on day minus 10, not too much ATG, Cy, Flu, Pew, and we started cyclosporin on day minus 6, and continue with post-transplant Cy and cyclosporin MMF. We'll consider plasma exchange if the DSA are high. We can consider donor platelet transfusion at the time of the stem cell infusion if the patient is having a high titer of DSA. So my take-home message is that haplo data are improving in all indications, including transfusion-dependent thalassemia measure. We are on the learning curve, and start today, otherwise tomorrow will never come. I'll stop here, and thanks for attention.